What an exciting time to be running an AI model developer in Canada, also in Silicon Valley, sort of in the UK. Where are you based, Aidan? You're sort of a man of many countries.
Yeah, I mostly based on a plane, but Cohere has really changed its revenue from all being concentrated in North America to we're opening offices in Seoul, in Tokyo, in Riyadh, in Dubai, in Paris. And obviously I live here in London. And so there's a lot of travel involved. And also, you know, my family history, I was born in Canada, but my mom is British, my dad is Spanish. So I hold three passports. So Cohere has always been highly, highly international.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, you and Cohere, and that puts you in a very unique position to talk about the theme of the tech conference this year, which is tech sovereignty. And I want to pose a question that's been posed to other speakers today, which is, what does that phrase even mean? And two, how is Cohere using that to pitch its customers in the US versus, say, Europe?
I think for Cohere, what sovereignty means is control. No one can switch it off. And so you have control over the technology, the infrastructure that your country or your company depends on. And something that's unique about our deployment model relative to our competitors is the fact that we can deploy on-prem, we can deploy air-gapped, and of course we can deploy on cloud. And so what that means is instead of asking the customer to send their data to us, for us to process and send back responses, we send all of our software, all of our models to the customer. We can't see in, we have no backdoor access. You can literally unplug the machine from the internet. It keeps running. And so you have full control. There's no world in which those systems can be interfered with or observed or monitored by Cohere.
How does the fact that the company is technically based in Canada help you when you are selling in the US and help you when you are selling outside of the US?
I think inside the US, the relationship between, I mean, it's like the special relationship. We are one of the US's largest trading partners,
good
talent,
friends.
Very good friends historically. So very close relations, and families are connected across the border. Talent migrates between the two pretty much freely. Tons of tourism and that type of thing. So in the US, and also we have this accent, and so we can kind
Same.
Of blend in. But in the US, we're sort of viewed as a cousin or a brother. We're very warm. And then outside of the US, I think right now with different geopolitical events that are happening and different changes in the global trade system, us being Canadian has been quite an asset. And so when we come to Europe and when we come to Asia, we present a friendly Canadian approach and posture that people, I think, are quite eager to work with and partner with. And of course, Canada in general, as a Canadian, I understand that we need to diversify our trade relationships globally. And so I want to contribute to that. Cohere is an exporter. We want to be the world's partner to adopting this technology and deploying it inside of the global economy.
You mentioned that at one point your revenue was very heavily tied to North America. Can you give us an idea of what that looked like before, maybe like a year ago versus today?
A year ago, it would have been, I think, 80% plus, maybe even 90% plus US-centric revenue. At this point, I think that's down to potentially a majority being outside the United States, maybe slightly, still a modest majority in the US. So we've diversified massively, and that's through partnerships in, you know, in Seoul, in Tokyo, in Riyadh, here in London. So yeah, we've made a big push to be the world's partner. Some of our strengths on that front are the fact that we're Canadian, that we do these private deployments, but also the fact that from a very early stage, the models that we build, we prioritize multilinguality. And so their ability to speak and act in Arabic, in Korean, in Japanese, it's a really unique model in terms of its performance in those domains. The others are super English-centric. As soon as you start trying to do the same use cases in a non-English language, you see this substantial quality drop immediately. Whereas with Cohere, we've fought to preserve that. There is still some drop, but it's much more modest.
I want to take a sharp turn We have to talk about the prospects of an AI bubble, because that's what secretly everybody in this room is worried about. And that's because of all these multi-billion dollar deals that your much larger competitors like OpenAI and Anthropic are doing with other companies. I mean, CoreWeave, we just heard from. You know, that is namely in the data center capacity space, as well as the purchase of advanced AI chips. Are they all making a big mistake?
I think it remains to be seen. I can say that we're not taking that strategy. We've always focused on building models that are right-sized to industry. So when you're deploying into the enterprise market, they don't have infinite GPUs. It's extremely constrained in terms of access to hardware because of cost controls. You don't want to spend $1 billion a year on your compute cluster. And so we build models. I think here on the graphic on screen, you can see relative to other models, we use a fraction of the number of GPUs, and that's intentional. We set a constraint, which is our model has to fit on two GPUs. We're going to squeeze as much performance out of it, but we're not going to go beyond two GPUs so that we can access and serve as much as of market as possible. With others, when they're doing these consumer deployments and they're chasing AGI, I don't think there are a lot of fiscal constraints being put in place, and so they have to build out massive computing infrastructure to actually deliver this technology. I'm hopeful that a push for efficiency will come, you know, for the sake of the planet and for the sake of really just scaling this up and putting it in more hands. But I'm watching those deals like you are, and sort of scratching my head.
So I want to take us back to January. I can't believe it was this year. DeepSeek was this year.
Yeah, wow.
Can you believe that? And, you know, it felt like it came out of nowhere, and it was this massive wake-up call to the entire AI ecosystem. It threw the entire economics of AI out the window and had everyone questioning everything. They said that they built this AI model at a cost a fraction of its much larger rivals. And I remember when we were chronicling it, we quoted you in a story as saying the future of LLMs belongs to those who focus on more efficient techniques, not more compute. Mm-hmm. Tell me more about what you meant by that, and how is Cohere staying true to that?
Well, I think this is a good example of us being committed to that mission, the fact that we're able to fit our technology on a much smaller footprint. We focus so much on efficiency. And I think good technology development requires constraints. And that's something that a lot of others in the space haven't been operating under. DeepSeek was a wake-up moment, for sure. It came out 3-4 months after the OpenAI O1 model, which was the first reasoning model, huge breakthrough, tons of excitement, and it performed about as well 3 months later for an exceptionally small amount of spend and compute relative to OpenAI. And so I think some of the posturing or some of the narrative broke in that moment. That's not to say that we don't need more compute. Of course, like as this technology goes out into the world and as we start to deploy it into production, inference compute is incredibly, incredibly important. But I think the process of developing the models, it's not just bigger, bigger, bigger. I think if you look over the past year, you've seen a series of model releases from many of the major labs which show a plateauing or a slowing down in progress while they were pursuing spending 10 times as much to train the model, building a 10 times larger cluster of compute.
Which models are you talking about, Aidan?
I won't name names. But definitely, I think some of these narrative postures need to be questioned. Another one was, you know, early on, again, I won't name names, but some folks were saying, we're ahead. No one will ever be able to catch up. And at this point in time today, we have a set of like 7 models. They're all approximately the same. Everyone has caught up. You know, it's all sort of converging to the same fixed point. And so I think if people look back a year or 2 years to see what was said by some of my peers in the industry, a lot of it is not panning out. The one thing they said that is panning out is that this technology is incredible. There's now like over a billion people using this technology on a daily basis, weekly basis, and it's only going to grow from here. On the enterprise side, we're still incredibly early. We're just starting to see real at-scale deployment.
Let's talk about that, because I do want to get into the finances of the AI companies, and you know, your comms team has reminded me multiple times that you don't give financial projections for Cohere. But I will say that, you know, there are a lot of analysts who are projecting that rivals like OpenAI aren't going to become profitable until 2029. That's years out, and yet they're out there signing these multi-billion-dollar deals. I just wanted to know if you could give us an idea, being so business-oriented and profit-oriented as you are, when you think companies like Cohere could start making a profit. Is it 2029?
For Cohere, I think it's sooner than that. And we have a differentiated deployment model. We have very high margins. It's similar to like traditional SaaS business, whereas many others in the industry, they're losing money per customer. And so we feel in a very good position to build a sustainable profit-generating business. I can't comment on others, but we feel really confident in our own position.
You know, I thought that it might be helpful for you to break down the business model of Cohere and how it differs from some of your competitors in terms of compute and what you have to invest in and what you actually don't. Do you mind explaining?
Yeah, sure. So for a consumer offering, they have to onboard a bunch of free users who don't pay them and use this service, and they need to serve those models. And so that's a huge cost. It's only negative margin. There's no money coming in. Then there's a small set of users, maybe 5%, maybe 10%, who do pay. And you have to hope that they don't use it enough to overwhelm what they're paying you in terms of compute. For Cohere, our deployment model is we sell software. So like I was saying, we send over our models, we send over our software to the customer's hardware. And so it's a software business. We don't pay for hardware. It is all margin except for, you know, what it costs us to market, and that's basically a cost of sales.
We can't ignore the phrase that is spooking market these days, and by that we're talking about circular financing, and by that we're talking about companies like NVIDIA investing in OpenAI, and OpenAI in turn buying chips from NVIDIA. On the demand front, how worried do you think that we should be that the AI boom is being propped up by the AI ecosystem itself as opposed to real demand generating real revenue?
Right now, I think there is obviously very real demand. Just the number of users, I'm sure you use it in your personal life. I'm sure everyone, almost everyone here.
Not to write stories, of course.
No, sure. Of course not. Yeah. All the hallucinations, et cetera. I think there is very obvious real demand, real utility. People are using this stuff, and they're using it a ton. And so there definitely does need to be more infrastructure. On the enterprise side, like I was saying, it's still super early. The enterprise use of this, it's in our economies, it's barely gotten started. I don't even think it's single-digit percentage points of where it will be. So there needs to be more infrastructure. Some would argue that the financing between NVIDIA and others is actually just more efficient. It's cutting out the middleman between these processes. And so maybe that's true. I think the scale really matters. If the scale becomes too large, and if demand does not meet expectations or assumptions that were made as part of these deals, that's when you get a insolvency or some sort of break in the system. Time will tell.
When do you think we'll start seeing at least?
Well, they're all getting done this year. It takes 3 years to build out capacity. We'll know in like 2 years, 3 years.
2-3 years.
Were these assumptions correct or not?
Yeah. I want to get a little bit into the financing of Cohere itself. You raised a massive $500 million round just in August that valued the company at $7 billion. And then a month later, you raised another $100 million. And we, of course, reported last night that you are holding a secondary tender of employee shares. And congratulations, your annualized revenue has now reached $150 million. What's next? What's after that? Are you going to break? Are you going to be the next $500 billion AI company? What's your goal?
You know, I think we're on our way. The focus for us is actually getting this technology into production. So not into POCs and science projects. We just want to make companies able to deploy it into the real work that they do to create ROI And so for us, that's a product mission. It's about lowering those barriers. One of the big ones is privacy, which I've spoken about, and I think we have a unique product offering on that front. But beyond that, it's also about integrating it into these organizations. Each company, they use a different set of tools, right? Like the software that they use is different. And for these models to actually create the value for those enterprises, it needs to use the same tools, the same software that the humans use. So it needs to be given access to all those same tools that you use, your CRM, your ERP, your email, blah, 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 blah. So that integration process of showing up at a company, taking these agents, and then opening their access to the suite of tools the humans use, that's going to take a while. Like it fundamentally takes labor to go implement and integrate these systems and give them that access. So our focus is on shortening the time to do that, speeding up velocity on that front. Because once those models have access to all of that context, then you can start to automate things and achieve ROI.
And that increases your margins. What are your margins now?
I'm not going to say a number.
No, nothing?
But really good.
Really good. Really healthy.
Amazing.
assuming you are not entertaining a takeover offer from Google, Meta, Microsoft, no. Assuming that, when do you think you'll take the company public?
I don't know. I don't want to jinx it. But I think soon. We're on a clear path to profitability. And so I think public market investors would be excited to have a pure play AI investment opportunity as opposed to investing by proxy through hyperscalers, et cetera. So I hope soon, but I don't want to jinx it.
Do you think that you would entertain an offer to list here in the UK?
Sure, yeah. I think if there's enough investment capital, I think that is one of the constraints. I live in Soho. Like I said, my mom's British and I live here, and I really want to support this ecosystem and this economy. One of the core constraints is access to capital. And I think that's something that we all need to be thinking about in terms of supporting the innovation ecosystem. But if that exists, then yeah, of course, we'll be rational economic actors and list wherever.
We heard NatWest chairman earlier today talk about that problem, that financing problem. He gave specific examples of what the government could do in terms of pushing more pension money into VCs.
Yes, yeah.
Is that the solution? Are there specifics that you would like
I think
the
that would be
to?
Very effective. Yeah. Well, in Canada, we've sort of done that, right? So in Canada, we have these massive pension funds, CPPIB, OTPP. We have like $4 trillion under these pensions, and they're actively managed. They don't outsource the management. They actually have teams that deploy it. And so, I think that's a better strategy than what the UK has taken. But even in Canada, we struggle with, does that money get actively deployed domestically or abroad? A lot of Canadian capital flows abroad, the overwhelming majority of it. And so you do need a sovereign mandate if you want to change the status quo in your country.